right, good morning, everyone. Could you turn your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1? Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1. And just a couple announcements before we have our opening prayer. Remember our class schedule, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, 7 to 8. Thursday is our prayer meeting after service. Also, our website address is www.wenstrom.org. And all of our classes are recorded and videotaped, and the written documents for each verse that we've studied are on the website as well. And also, I'll be out of town. I'll be teaching Sunday, July 3rd, but from July 4th, Monday, July 4th, all the way to Saturday, July 16th, I'll be out of town. We'll resume classes on Sunday, July 17th. So, again, we have class Sunday, July 3rd. I'll be flying right out that afternoon, so I'll have to leave right from here real quick on Sunday. And then I'll be flying back to Massachusetts for 2 weeks. I'll be back on the 16th of July on a Saturday, and so all those classes in between will be canceled, so as we usually take our summer break. So without further ado, let's take that moment of silent prayer before we get underway, before we have our music, the time for music, and also the study of the Word. So with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, let us pray. Father, we thank you for this time to gather together with each other as members of the royal family of God, the body of Christ, the future bride of Christ. We thank you, Father, for revealing yourself to us, revealing who and what you are and what your Son is in the Spirit, and what you've done for us through them and are doing for us now and will do for us in the future. Father, we thank you for being sovereign over our lives, and we know that you're in control. And we just pray, Father, for our ministry. We just lift up our ministry, and we just pray that you would add positive volition to this ministry. And we just pray, Father, you would break down the barriers Satan has put up and guide us as to what you would have us do. We also pray that we thank you for the Thompsons opening up their home to us. We thank you for their graciousness and their hospitality. And we just thank you for those who are here this morning that have a love for your word. And we thank you for our brothers and sisters in Christ that might be listening on Pound Talk now or viewing or listening to this class at a later date through the website. We just thank you for them, and we just thank you, Father, for the privilege that you've given us to take part in a gospel ministry. And we just pray, Father, that you would help all of us to grow in love toward you and each other, and that the Spirit would reveal to us through the teaching of the Word that you're in control of our lives and that you love us, and help us to reflect that love back to each other, and also to be more dedicated and devoted to you, denying self and taking up our cross daily as your Son taught us. And Father, we pray that you would give grace to the communicator, help him to concentrate and to deliver your full counsel to your people so that they might be built up and edified spiritually, and you and your Son Jesus Christ would be lifted up and glorified. We just pray, Father, for those in the audience that concentrate, that we pray that no one would do anything that's disturbing and distracting to those who are serious students of the Word of God. And we just pray that they would receive the necessary spiritual nourishment. And also, Father, we pray, Father, that you would help Titus with the sound and the recordings. And we just pray everything would go smoothly with that, with the technology as well. And so we pray that the song service would bring glory to you, that each of us would sing as unto you and not be self-conscious or distracted by anything, that just sing out to you, and also that the teaching would bring glory to you as well. So, Father, we pray for these things in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Could you rise, please? We're going to do I'll Fly Away. Thank you.
When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Some bright morning, when this life is over, I'll fly away to a land on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have flown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from these prison walls, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end.
Thank you.
How can I live to show my world the treasure of Jesus? What will it take? What could I give so they can know the treasure is? And if I can sing them a song, be full of His glory, and if I can speak, let my words be full of His grace, and if I should live or die, let me be found pursuing this prize, one that alone satisfies. Treasure of Jesus. And if I can sing them my songs before of His glory, and if I can speak, let all my words be full of His grace, and if I should live or die, let me be found pursuing this prize, one that alone satisfies the treasure of Jesus. Oh, 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 oh.
You should be at Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1, and as we do the first Sunday of each month, we've been doing this for the last 6 months or so, we're doing a study on the unique person of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and we're studying the different aspects of the person of Jesus Christ. And in the past, we've studied the pre-existence of Christ. We've studied from the Scriptures that He's always existed before entering the human race permanently 2,000 years ago. We also studied His deity, and that He is equal to the Father in the Spirit. We also study the incarnation, where He entered the human race. And as a result, we have Jesus Christ, the Son of God, having a human nature. So we study the human nature of Jesus Christ. And now what we're going to do this morning is we're going to study the hypostatic union of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And this simply means, as we're going to develop it further here this morning, that Jesus Christ is both God and man. The Bible teaches, the scriptural evidence is overwhelmingly that Jesus of Nazareth, who is the Christ, is both God and man forever. So He has two distinct natures. What we're going to see this morning, we're going to study how the relationship of the two natures, how do they function with each other? And what does it mean that Jesus added a human nature? I've read a lot of theology throughout the years on great men of God, but I don't think, I'm going to try to make a distinction here. I'm going to try to really nail down what it meant, or at least contribute somewhat, to theology, as to what it meant that He added a human nature, or He veiled Himself or clothed His deity with a human nature. What does it mean that He did that, that He became a human being? So Jesus has two distinct natures, the Bible teaches. and which as to the attributes differ significantly, and they were brought together into personal union, which will continue forever. So in theology, or specifically the study of Christ, which is called Christology, the term hypostatic union, which we're going to study this morning, is used by theologians to describe the teaching of the scriptures that Jesus Christ is undiminished deity and true sinless humanity in one person forever. He's the God-man, or you might say he's the incarnate word of God. That incarnate is the word we studied in the study of the incarnation. He became a human being. He entered into the human existence. He had a human body just like ours, human emotions, everything he experienced, except he was without sin. So the word hypostatic, don't be intimidated by the word. The word hypostatic is actually a biblical word, as we're going to see in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. And the word, as we're going to see this morning, means nature or essence. And therefore, when you use the word union with this word, hypostatic, which is from a Greek word, hypostasis, it actually speaks of a nature. So you put the word union with this word, and you have the union of two natures, the nature of God and the nature of a human being in the person of Jesus Christ. So look at Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1, because in this passage, Hebrews 1, 3, we see that the word hypostatic is actually a Bible word, meaning that it's derived from the original language of Scripture. It says in Hebrews 1, 1, God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers and the prophets in many portions and in many ways, and these last days, and as we're in the last days now, has spoken to us in his Son, or through his Son, and whom he appointed his Son, the Father appointed his Son, heir of all things, through whom also he made the world. He's the creator. Jesus Christ is the instrument, that second member of the Trinity who accomplished this. And then it says in verse 3 that Jesus Christ is the radiance of his glory, the Father, and the exact representation of his nature. Jesus Christ perfectly manifested to the human race the nature of God. That's why he said to Philip, he who has seen me, Philip, has seen the Father. And then it says, and he upholds all things by the word of his power. When he had made purification of sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Now, when he says verse 3, and he is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature, the word nature is the word in the Greek is hypostasis. Hypostasis is a word that's translated here nature. And this Greek word belonged to the realm of science and medicine. And it had a variety of meanings in classical Greek. But here it's talking about the nature of God. It speaks of his essence. When I say the nature of God, I'm talking about the different attributes that compose him. For instance, he's sovereign. We know he's righteousness and justice. He's eternal life. He's omnipotence. He's everywhere present. That's omnipresence. He's all knowledge. He's omniscience. He's also veracity, truth. He's perfect truth. He's all these things. And, of course, he's love. Now, all these attributes help to compose his divine nature. Now, when we talk about nature, we can also use the word essence. In Webster's Ninth New Collegiate Dictionary defines this English word essence as the following: the properties or attributes by means of which something can be placed in its proper class or identified as being what it is. Or in other words, it refers, the word essence or nature refers to the nature of something. So we see that, as I mentioned, the attributes of God, Jesus had all these attributes. He's always possessed these attributes because he's the eternal Son of God. He's always existed and had perfect fellowship, harmonious rapport with both the Father and the Holy Spirit. So the doctrine of the hypostatic union teaches that our Lord's divine nature and his human nature were united forever. Now, when we use the word union, Webster defines the word union as an act or instance of uniting or joining two or more things into one. So if we paraphrase that definition from Webster's for the word union, we would say that Jesus Christ unites in himself the essence or nature of God and the essence or nature of man. So he is no one like him, as we've been pointing out. There's no one like him. This is very important that you understand this subject, because this is where all the cults come from. The cults don't understand the person of Christ, or they reject what the scripture says about him. And for instance, ascetic Gnosticism back in the second century, third century, and it's still around today, but with a different name. They deny that Jesus Christ was actually a human being. Jesus Christ was a human being. Gospel of John proves that definitively, and so does the other Gospels. So he was, when he was on the cross, he was a human being. And he, so Jesus Christ is united in himself, deity and humanity. Now the Father's not like him, and the Spirit's not like him, because neither one entered the human race. That's why the book, The Shack, is really ridiculous, because it portrays the Father as having scars. No, there's only one member of the Trinity who has scars, and that's because that's the Son of God, because he's the only one who entered the human race. So false doctrine comes into the church because of misunderstanding of the person of Jesus Christ. The Bible teaches he's both God and man. He's not 50-50. He's 100% deity and 100% human nature. He is just as much like you and I. He had a body. He had to go to the bathroom. He had to brush his teeth. He cried. He suffered. We studied all these things of the human nature of Christ. But he also, but he was God at the same time. So this makes him unique. And he's different from the human race, and that he's God, and he's sinless as well. Now, the New Testament emphatically teaches that in his person, Jesus of Nazareth, who is the Christ, was both God and he was and is both God and man. And we established this in previous classes. So I want you to take a cruise around different parts of the New Testament. Go to John's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 1, please. John 1, 1. John's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 1. John 1, 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word, this is a title for Jesus Christ, was with God, and the Word was God. Now, the word there, logos, translated word here. This is a talking about that Jesus Christ is communicating to, he's the member of the Trinity that communicates to the rest of the human race and the angels, his character and nature. He communicates to the rest of the God's creatures who he, God, is. So it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. That means he always existed with God face to face. And the Word was God. He is equal to the Father. Then it says in verse 2, he was in the beginning with God, and all things came into being, existence, through him. And apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. And there came a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify about the light, so that all might believe through him. And he was not the light, but he came to testify about the light. The light's another title for Jesus Christ. And there was the true light, which coming into the world enlightens every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. Did not know him, did not comprehend who he was. Even though Jesus performed all types of miracles that no man has ever accomplished and raised himself, was raised from the dead. So therefore, there was nobody like him in the history of the world. And yet, the very creatures that he brought into existence and everything we see here brought into existence by him did not comprehend him. And then it goes on to say in verse 11, and he came to his own. In the context, he's speaking of the Jews here. He was a Jew. And those who were his own did not receive him. They didn't accept him by faith. Think of the irony. Here he is, the creator, creates everything, and nobody wants to give him the time of day. Nobody wants to listen to him. And let me tell you something. It would be the same today if God the Son, if the incarnation, the birth of Christ took place now rather than 2,000 years ago, he would be the same old thing. People would not be looking for him, nor would they care to get to know him. That's the way human race is. Because man is a sinner by nature, and he's deceived by the devil, and he's deceived by Satan's cosmic system. And man doesn't know the true meaning of life because it doesn't know Jesus Christ by faith. Then it says in verse 12, but as many as received him, like you and I, received him through faith, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name. The word name there is speaking of his character. Who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Then look at what he says in verse 14. And the Word, which John's already established, is God. became flesh. He became a human being. He became something he wasn't before, a human being. And he dwelt among us, and we saw his glory. Glory is of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. So there we have Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Word of God, becoming a human being. Go to Philippians now. Go to Philippians chapter 2, verse 1. Philippians 2:1. Paul says in Philippians 2:1, therefore, if there's any encouragement in Christ, first class condition says that there is. If there's any consolation of love, there is. If there's any fellowship of the Spirit, and there is. If any affection and compassion, there is. Make my joy, Paul says, complete. By being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. Now look what it says. He gives Jesus as the perfect example of humility. Who, although he existed in the form of God, the essence of God, he did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, meaning he didn't exploit the fact that he was the Son of God. But he emptied himself, as we saw it's better in the King James, he made himself of no reputation. How did he do this? By taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men, being found, it says, in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So there we see he appeared to the human race as a human being. Now listen to me. He veiled his deity. And he didn't add anything to his deity because you can't add to deity. His attributes are complete. There's nothing you can add to God's deity. So when we say that he became a man, we're talking about he's veiled or he clothed himself with a human nature. And we're going to know what that means this morning, because it's a lot of people are confused about it. Even I've talked to some pastors in the past. They don't really understand what that means, that he became a human being, what that involves. So many of these passages, two of which we've read, make it clear that the eternal Son of God clothed or veiled his deity with a sinless human nature, and he became a human being. So this term hypostatic union means that deity and true humanity are combined in one personality forever, and that personality is Jesus Christ. Now listen, this is what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean he was two people, or he had two different personalities, one related to his human nature and one related to his deity. He was already a person. And as we'll see this morning, what makes a person the absolute essential mark of personhood is having a volition. And from that comes your mentality, because you can't use your volition unless you have rational thinking to be involved. So the mark of personhood is volition. God has one, the angels have one, and human beings do. So when it says he added to his human, he veiled his human nature, or he became a human being, entered the human race, we're not saying he had two different personalities. He had one personality, the one that was always his from eternity past as the second member of the Trinity. Because he's a man, does not make our Lord less than God, nor does his being God prevent him from being truly a man. So what I'm saying to you, when he was in the arms of Mary, he didn't cease being God. He was still, in fact, listen to me carefully. He was clothed himself in that human nature, and here he is as an infant. But his attributes were still functioning. They were just veiled to the human race. Very important that we see that. His attributes, to say his attributes weren't functioning while he was a baby or while he was hanging on the cross, is to deny his deity. His deity was always functioning. And the thing is, he veiled his attributes. He didn't always, most of the time, he didn't show who he really was. He veiled his deity, meaning he didn't always walk around, turning the stone, could he have turned the stones into bread when he was hungry? Could he have done that? Turn a tree into a cauliflower? Now, he could have done anything he wanted to, but he didn't do that. He veiled his omnipotence. He didn't exercise his omnipotence. Once in a while, he would show it off. He'd walk on the water, or they came to arrest him just to show who he was. Jesus, who you seek? Jesus of Nazareth. And he stepped forward. I am he. And he said, I am he, because that's what he said in the Old Testament. I'm the self-existent one. I am who I am. I'm the very one who spoke to Moses in the burning bush and Abraham and King David. I'm the one who is from eternity past, and they all fell backwards. Because he was manifesting a little bit of his omnipotence at that point. And also, he manifested his omnipotence by rising from the dead. Remember he said in John 2, I will tear down this temple, but in 3 days I'll raise it up again. That's Jesus speaking from his deity that he will be raising himself. The Father and the Spirit were also involved in the resurrection of Jesus, and so was Jesus' deity. So we see that Jesus Christ, the integrity of the attributes of his divine nature, were not corrupted or compromised by the fact that his divine nature was permanently united with a human nature. Don't miss that. Just because he became a man didn't mean that all of a sudden he was no longer omnipotent. He still maintained his omnipotence. Nor were the integrity of the attributes of his human nature corrupted or compromised by the fact that he was God. He was still a human being, even though he has always existed as the Son of God. His two natures, people, though united, retain their separate identities. For instance, his divine attributes are always united to his divine nature, and his human attributes are always united to his human nature. There's no mixing or matching of attributes. Otherwise, if you did that, like say for deity, he's no longer, you destroy his deity. His divine attributes and his human attributes are separate and distinct from each other. There's no mixing. Now, the reason why that is that the infinite cannot become finite. The infinite cannot become, the infinite is Jesus Christ. The infinite cannot become finite, and the immutable, remember, deity is immutable, cannot be changed. So to say that by becoming a human being, that his divine attributes were corrupted, or vice versa, his human attributes were corrupted, is therefore to destroy his deity, because the infinite cannot be finite, become finite, and the immutable, meaning it never changes, cannot be changed. So no attribute of deity was altered when our Lord became a man through the incarnation, and the same holds true when he died on the cross. Just because he was on the cross, you know, when it says he emptied himself in Philippians, we read that, that doesn't mean he emptied himself of his deity, because that's ridiculous. That denies that. Then he would know that would destroy deity. That would destroy his deity. And that's the bad translation. When it says, the King James actually has it closer. It says, he made himself of no reputation. How do you do that? By taking the form of a slave. By becoming a human being. So we see that to take away a single attribute of our Lord's divine nature would destroy his deity. To take away from his perfect human nature one attribute would destroy his humanity. Now, John Woolward, who used to be the president of Dallas Theological Seminary, has in his great book, and I would absolutely, if I was somebody, any Christian, I would get this book. It may seem dry to some people, but it's theology that's really solid that you need to have. It might not be one of those, fun, like a lot of books in Christianity today that just tickle the ears and has no substance. This has got chock full of solid information that you and I as Christians need. It's called Jesus Christ Our Lord. And on page 112, John Woolward writes, though Christ sometimes operated in the sphere of his humanity and in other cases in the sphere of his deity, in all cases, what he did and what he was could be attributed to his one person. Even though it is evident that there were two natures in Christ, he is never considered a dual personality, having two personalities. Woolward goes on to say, the normal pronouns such as I, you, and he are used of him frequently, end of quote. So, the two natures of Christ are not only united without affecting the attributes of the two natures, but they're also combined in one person. As Charles Hodge wrote, another great theologian who I differ on impeccability, but he was a great theologian, and he says the following, and I'm quoting, a very important statement. The Son of God did not unite himself with a human person. This is what he says. The Son of God did not unite himself with a human person, but with a human nature. End of quote. So the Lord Jesus Christ, when he became a human being, he didn't become a dual personality. And I remember one time I asked a question of a pastor who loves the Lord. I know. But he was wrong. I asked him one time, you know, did he have two wills? And he said, yes. And I was like, that. And I said to myself, that never. And I listened to it. I didn't really. And over the years, I've always, when people say, oh, he became a human being, a lot of Christians think that he had two wills. And when you say will, you're thinking volition. That's not the case. The volition that he has is related to his person as the Son of God. Remember, volition is not unique, as we'll say, to the divine nature or human nature or the angelic nature. All three, God, angels, and men, have volition. It's the mark of personhood, volition. Okay? So when it says he became a man, it doesn't mean he added to himself a human volition. The volition he had was related to his personhood as the Son of God. And this is where a lot of Christians and theologians get messed up and screw up. And so this, I want to nail this down so understand this. So we see here that the Lord Jesus Christ was always aware of his deity and always aware of his humanity. He was always aware in himself with respect to his deity. And listen to me, he grew in self-consciousness with respect to his humanity. There was no point in the life of our Lord when he suddenly became aware that he was the Son of God. I used to think that when he became a man, when he was a baby, that it took a while before he grew up that he became aware that he was deity. That's not the case at all. He was aware, this is what makes it even more astounding. He was aware that he was God as a baby. To say he wasn't is to say he's not God. Now think about that. This is why the angels were astounded. God the Son, who created everything, who's worshipped by the angels, is sitting in that, he's decided to put himself, to add to, clothe himself, veil himself, enter the human race, and here he is lying in the arms of Mary. Yet he's totally aware that he's a baby at this point, an infant. Now you and I can't understand that because we're not deity. So don't try to understand what that's like I tried to. Because no one can identify with that, only the Son of God. See, when we entered the human race, we had to grow. Our souls grew with our human nature. Well, they should. So, in a normal sense. But we became aware that we were a person, what, 3 or 4 maybe? Well, I don't know when it was, you know, where, at such and such point. But Jesus was always aware who he was as a person. I'm God. So no one was like him. No human being was ever like him because he had a self-awareness right from the beginning in infancy. So we don't know what that's like, but he does. Only he can identify with what he is because he's unique. Now, let's keep going. It is his divine self-consciousness was always, listen to me carefully, was always fully operative when he was an infant in the arms of Mary. And this was the case as a mature adult. Now, that, again, is different from us. We become self-conscious, 2, 3, 4, I don't know, it's different for different people, all right? We become aware that we are, that we exist. Jesus was unique, right from the beginning. As soon as he entered into to that fetus and emerged from the womb, as soon as that moment he emerged from the womb, he was aware that he had entered the human race. He was aware, he was conscious of himself as a human being. And that's different than I was taught years ago, and so I've grown over the period of years studying this over the years and praying on it for a number of years. So it's clear that that being the case, that he was always aware that he was God, and as he became an infant, you know, entering into the human race, and here he is an infant, he was always aware of that. Now, here's another mind bender, though. It's clear from the scriptures, though, that with regards to his human nature, that his human nature developed. Okay? So there was a corresponding development of his human self-consciousness as his human nature developed. Therefore, our Lord had a divine and human self-consciousness. However, there was never any conflict between the two. Hold your place. Look at Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, for a second. Show you something. Luke chapter 2. Now, this subject we're studying is been the some of the greatest minds in the Christian church throughout the centuries have been totally blown away by this whole subject, because we'll never get to the bottom of this. There's things about the person of Christ that we'll never quite know, and he's going to have to tell us. You know, that there are some things we do need to know. He is both God and man. And we need to know that he is, as a person, has always existed. That's important. That's essential. He was always conscious of being God. There was never a time he wasn't conscious of being God. Now, his human nature had to develop, though. That's obvious because, you know, his body grew and he had to eat food. And his human body had to grow. So look at what it says in Luke. It talks about this in Luke. Look at what it says in Luke chapter 2. Look at verse 41. Luke 2:41. Now his parents, Mary and Joseph, went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. Good Jews. And when he became 12, they went up there according to the custom of the feast. Now mind you, he's totally aware that he's God. Imagine you being a 12-year-old boy and you know you're God. But see, remember, we're thinking it from an immature perspective. Boy, I could take out that bully at any time, you know. But no, he was totally, and so there was a self-control, of course, that's from God's own nature, where there was never any point where he would, you know, somebody was being a jerk as a little 12-year-old to him, some kid in school, and he was going to turn the kid into a devil dog or something, you know. There was never any threat of that, because he's God. He's a God of love, okay. He would love the child, and he perfectly exemplified God's love because he is God. So it says in verse 42, and when he became 12, they went up there according to the custom of the feast. And as they were returning, and after spending the full number of days, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents were unaware of it, but supposed him to be in the caravan. They all traveled together. It was strength in numbers and protection from bandits. And they went a day's journey, and they began looking for him among their relatives and acquaintances. So he went with the rest of the kids. He was playing with the rest of the kids. I mean, that must have been fun. He's God playing with the rest of the kids, and, you know, which tells you something about God's attitude toward kids. So he's with the other kids probably. Who knows? He could have been reading the scriptures too. I'm sure he was. But look what it goes on to say. Verse 45. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem looking for him. Then after 3 days, they found him in the temple. Where else would he be? Sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when they saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us in this way? Behold, your father and I have been anxiously looking for you." And he said to them, "Why is it that you were looking for me? Did you not know that I had to be in my father's house?" They both know who he is. The angels told him, God told him through the angels, "This is the Son of God." Now, what does that tell you? Listen, think about that. What's the implication here? He was carrying on just like any other 12-year-old boy, though he was perfect in his obedience. We know that because he's God. But he wasn't trying to show off at any point his deity. God doesn't do that. He was just acting like any other, which means they had gotten so familiar to him that he was just another 12-year-old boy, though a lot different because he obeyed all the time. But here he is, a 12-year-old boy, and they didn't think of him as the Son of God because he was just carrying on, growing, living a normal life as any old 12-year-old boy, Jewish boy, would. So, don't imagine the self-restraint on the part of God. Now, look at it says in verse 50. But they did not understand the statements which he had made to them. I still don't know why that is. They should have known from all the angels talking to them and everything they heard and at his birth. I mean, come on. But they forgot. And verse 51, and he went down with them, and he came to Nazareth, and he continued in subjection to them. And his mother treasured all these things in her heart. So next time a kid is disobedient, say, hey, Jesus, the Son of God, obeyed Mary and Joseph. He created them both. He's the only person who could say, I created my parents. Think about that. Yet, you hear kids, like, you know, I'm not going to, you know, obey my parents. Well, Jesus, the Son of God, did. Why can't you? So Jesus, it says in verse 52, kept increasing in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. And it says Jesus there because it's emphasizing his human nature. He grew up, got stronger. He became, in his human nature, more and more mature. And again, his deity was restraining himself. See, his deity, he was restraining, manifesting his attributes to the human race. He had veiled them. He was still using them, but he was veiling them to the human race. So there we have, there was no point. Again, we see Jesus Christ, there was never any conflict between his divine and human self-consciousness. Now, sometimes he spoke and acted from his divine self-consciousness, and other times from his human self-consciousness. Remember in John 17, 5, he said, Father, in his great high priestly prayer, you know, glorify your son as the glory he had before the creation of the world. That's him speaking from his deity. So he sometimes, the scriptures record him speaking and acting from his divine self-consciousness, and other times from his human self-consciousness. Remember when they came to arrest him and he said, I am he, and they fell backwards? That's him coming, speaking from his divine consciousness. So Jesus Christ was also conscious of being omnipotent and that he was the promised Savior of the world. There was never a point that he didn't know that, because he's the eternal Son of God who's always existed, and he was aware of that as he was in the arms of Mary, as he was hanging on the cross, every area of his life, every moment of his human life. So the question, here's the big question that I touched on earlier. The question arises that since Jesus Christ had a divine and human nature, did each nature have a corresponding will? Let me ask that question again. Listen to it. The question arises that since Christ had a divine and human nature, did each nature have a corresponding will? Now, let's define our terms. In order to answer this question, we must define what the word will means, W-I-L-L. If we speak of the will in terms of desire, then it is clear that there would be a conflicting desire in the divine and human natures of Christ. Like, he had human desires, which could conflict at certain times with his divine nature. Perfect example is in the Garden of Gethsemane. You know, Father, you know, you're shrinking from the cup. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. So his human nature and his divine natures had conflicting desires there. That's a manifestation of that. However, if by will that we mean volition, then we know that one person can have only one will. Do you have one volition? Volition means you make decisions. You're different from the animal kingdom and the insect kingdom and marine life, and this is clear, because you have a volition, a will, as some say. You can make decisions. And to have a volition presupposes a mentality. Because to make a decision, you have to be able to make rational thought. So when I say volition, that is, this is what I'm talking from now. Did Jesus have two volitions? Did he have a volition with his divine nature and his human nature? Or was it just his divine nature? So the mark, now this is what the question is. The mark of personhood, whether of an angel or a man or God himself, is that of volition. That is, and the reason why I could say that is easy. Because God has a volition, man has a volition, angels have a volition. So volition is not unique to any of those, divine nature, angelic nature, or human nature. Volition is in all of those natures. So so to have a human nature doesn't mean volition is not actually what helps to compose human nature. Let me repeat that. Volition doesn't really help to compose human nature. Why? Because volition is also in the divine nature, angelic nature, and human nature. What is volition then? It's the mark of personhood. We have to make that distinction. It makes you a person. Okay? An animal, A dog and a cat is not a person. Why? They have no volition. And therefore, they have no rational thought. Because they have volition means you have a mentality. So the dogs, the animals, the cats, any marine life, whales, fish, they don't have rational thought. They're not persons because they don't have a volition. However, men and angels, and God's a person. In fact, we know that there's the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So volition doesn't help to compose the divine or human nature, or the nature of angels for that matter. Why? Because volition is not unique to the nature of God, or man, or the nature of angels for that matter. God has a volition, and men and angels do. Therefore, now I bring this up because, listen to me carefully, when we speak of our Lord having a human nature, or that he has human attributes, we're not including volition. Because it's not, volition's not unique to God's nature, to human nature, or angelic nature. What is volition then? It's the mark of personhood. Therefore, our Lord had only one volition, but yet he clothed his divine nature with human attributes that do not include volition. Why? Let me repeat it again. Volition doesn't help to compose the divine nature, or human nature, or angelic nature, but rather it helps to constitute personhood. Again, and so that, because that being the case, how could Jesus add a human volition or acquire one? Let's put it that way. He couldn't, because he already has he's already a person, and therefore, because he's already a person, means he already has a volition. Because a volition is not unique to divine nature, angelic nature, or human nature. It constitutes personhood. So therefore, he couldn't have acquired a human will, volition, when he became a human being. Very important. Thus, when the Son of God became a man, he did not attach himself to another human being. Because that's what you're saying. If you're saying he acquired a human volition, now you're saying he's attached himself to another human being. Because volition is what makes a human being. And then, of course, he have all these other attributes. But if you strip away the body of man, what makes man is that he has a volition. He's in the image of God. One of the reasons why he's the image of God is he can make decisions like God does. So we see here that the Son of God, when he became a human being, he did not attach himself to another person or add a human will because he was already a person. But rather, when he became a human being, he clothed his divine nature with the attributes of a human being. Physical body, arms, legs, feet. Okay? Now, we must also not confuse God's volition. Now, I know somebody, I asked myself this question. Okay, what about his sovereignty? Well, being sovereign doesn't have, it's related to volition, but it isn't volition. The fact that God's sovereign doesn't mean he has a volition. We must not confuse God's volition with the attribute of his sovereignty, though they're related to each other, obviously. Now, listen to me. As applying to God, the term sovereignty indicates God's complete power over all creation, and listen carefully, so that he exercises his volition over his creatures, whether men or angels, which constitutes his sovereignty over them. God exercises his volition absolutely without any necessary conditioning by the volition of his creatures, whether men or angels, which constitutes his sovereignty over them. Meaning, you and I and angels, including Satan, can make our decisions before and against them. He still has dominion over them because he's always existed. And he already figured all the decisions by both men and angels that every angel and every man would ever commit throughout angelic and human history. He already figured their decisions into his plan. So God's never taken by surprise. Wasn't taken by surprise by the fall of Adam or Satan, because he's omniscient and he's sovereign. And he chose which decisions were to be take place and which were not. And he also figured in the plan what he would do. And what he would do was save us from our sins and Satan. So as applying to God, the term sovereignty indicates his complete power over all of creation, so that he, God, exercises volition or will, we could say, absolutely, without any necessary conditioning by a finite volition or volitions. So therefore, God exercises his volition absolutely without any necessary conditioning by the volition of his creatures, whether men or angels, which constitutes his sovereignty over them. Therefore, Jesus Christ did not have two volitions, but rather one, namely the volition related to his divine nature. When the Son of God clothed his divine nature with a human nature, this did not include a human volition, since the implication of that would be that the Son of God attached himself to another person. And that is ridiculous, because, again, volition is the mark of personhood. It doesn't help to compose, it's not unique to the divine nature, it's not unique to the angelic nature, it's not unique to human nature. It's the mark of personhood. So when he became a human being, he did not attach himself to another human being, and he therefore didn't require another human volition. That's not the case. So as he's in the arms of Mary, as he's the little boy, a 12-year-old boy in the temple, as he's dealing with his parents, Mary and Joseph, as he breaks out on his own and starts his ministry, as he's crucified, every step of the way, he's aware of who he is. Sometimes he speaks from his deity, as God the Father has directed him to, and a lot of the times, he functioned according to his human nature. Veiling his divine attributes, they were still functioning, just not to public view, before the human race. Sometimes God said, manifest them, and he would do so. And the resurrection was the great manifestation that he was the Son of God. So hopefully this adds to, my prayer is that this adds to your appreciation of the Lord. And now we can segue into the communion service. And so what we're going to do is have Titus is going to pass out the communion elements, and he's going to start a song. I'll sing us a song called Scars, and sing your list of songs that I'm going to do. And then we'll observe the communion table. This is a beautiful song written by Ray Bolts called Scars. Take your time, Dennis. Yep. Thank you.
I heard him call my name, said I'm going to save you, but I was so ashamed. I turned and walked away, but he reached out his hand, said I have something to show you. And what I saw changed my life that day. I saw his scars. No, he didn't try to hide them. He said, come and look inside them. They're a window to my heart. And don't forget I love you just the way you are. I knew it must be true. I saw his scars. I said, Lord, the scars are deep. I don't want you to see them. So many of them were caused by things I chose to do. He said, look again at the ones that I am wearing. Don't you know I chose these scars too? I saw his scars. No, he didn't try to hide them. He said, come and look inside them. They're a window to my heart. And don't forget I love you just the way you are. I knew it must be true. I saw his scars. One day in heaven, when we are on our knees, we'll look up to Jesus. I believe we'll see. We'll see His stars. No, we will not try to hide them. He'll see, come and look inside them. They're a window to my heart. Don't forget I love you just the way you are. We'll know that it's true. We'll see His scars. We'll see His scars. No, we will not try to hide them. He'll say, come and look inside them. They're a window to my heart. Don't forget I love you just the way you are. Oh, we'll know that it's true, because He died for me and you. Oh, we'll know that it's true. We'll see His scars.
Thanks, Titus. All right, we now come to the communion service, and we're going to bring into remembrance our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And this morning's class hopefully will contribute to what you think about during the communion service. You know, and during the communion service, especially when we're teaching the Word of God, you should be concentrating on what is being taught to you. But also, when we come to communion service, this is a test as to what we know about our Lord. And one thing we can boast about in life is our knowledge of Him, that we know Him. Jeremiah talks about that. Paul quoted Jeremiah in regards to that in 1 Corinthians. So when we come to the communion service, we have this bread and juice in front of us. And unfortunately, some have failed to understand the meaning of these two elements. Bread and juice are two common elements, and Jesus actually took two things, two human functions, eating and drinking, to bring into remembrance beautifully His person and work on the cross. Remember, the communion service, the Lord's Supper, was taken from the Passover service. In fact, in one of the cups, the cup of redemption, which is the third cup in the Jewish Passover, is the cup that Jesus took and used in the Lord's Supper. And the bread, remember, in the Jewish Passover, there'd be three pouches and one for each member of the Trinity, and there would be a piece of bread, unleavened bread, in each pouch. And Jesus took from the one, the middle pouch, from His, speaking of Himself. And this bread speaks of His human nature. Remember, God can't die spiritually or physically for us, suffer for us, unless He has to enter the human race. And so by becoming a human being, it enabled Him to suffer for us and to suffer for our sins. And also, what He did at the cross was negate everything that Adam did. All the failure of Adam in disobeying God in the Garden of Eden, He reversed everything. He negated everything that Adam did by disobeying God, by eating the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Not only that, but He gave us much more than Adam ever lost. We studied that in Romans chapter 5, 12 through 21. So when we come to the communion service, we look at the bread. The bread speaks of the human nature of Jesus Christ. And it was made with unleavened bread. Leaven, many times in the Bible, speaks of evil. And we see Paul making reference to this with the Corinthians. But we see that this bread portrays His human nature. And it's made with unleavened bread because leaven, as I said before, many times in the Scripture symbolizes evil. So it was made with unleavened bread to portray the fact, to depict the fact that Jesus Christ didn't have the principle of evil in him, the sin nature. He was sinless. So it speaks of his impeccability, his sinlessness, this bread, as well as his human nature. The cup also speaks, we use juice. It doesn't matter if you use juice or wine, especially with kids around, it's probably better using juice. But some places, they'll use wine. Now, the point of the matter is, it all represents his death on the cross, the blood of Christ. And the blood of Christ in the scriptures, it speaks of not only his physical death, but also his spiritual death as well. When he said, hung on the cross and said, my God, why have you forsaken me? From his human consciousness, he was speaking there. So we see that he's hanging on the cross and he died on the sin, died a spiritual death in our place. Remember, we died spiritually. Adam died spiritually when he disobeyed God in the garden. So Jesus Christ's spiritual death was essential to deal with the problem of spiritual death in the human race. His physical death was important because the sin nature is resident in our physical bodies. And when he died physically, he basically was taking care of the problem of the sin nature. And rising from the dead, he gave us a guarantee of a resurrection body minus the sin nature. So Jesus Christ's death and his person are portrayed here in the communion service. And this is what we're to dwell upon. It takes a lot of discipline mentally, and you can do it through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's why we take, before class, we take that moment of silent prayer so that we can concentrate and not only in the teaching, but also when we come to worship Jesus in the communion service. This is not a time to feel guilty. That's a sin. It's a time to be thankful to the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit for the gift of salvation, for the Father forgiving his Son, and that was an expression of his love. And Jesus becoming a man was an expression of the love of God. His suffering on the cross was an expression of his love for human race. His resurrection was an expression of that love for us. And that love, he loved us when we were his enemies. And nobody loves like that. You could say, well, what about the soldier that goes to war? One of the noblest things you can do, closest thing to the cross as you can get. The soldier goes to love his country. He goes because of his love for country and his family. But he doesn't go to die for his enemies. He goes to kill the country's enemies, right? Well, God the Son became a man to die for his enemies. That's why his love is unique. It's not of this world. Jesus manifested a love in his life that was not of this world. He loved his enemies. He forgave his enemies. He did all that. Death on the cross was for the very people who were crucifying him, for the very people's sins that put him on the cross. So that is your God. That's my God. And no matter what happens in life, no matter what happens to us, no matter what suffering we go through in life, we know that he has our best interests in mind. No matter if we lose a child, a loved one, if we lose our health, if we lose our homes, if we lose our jobs, or whatever it happens in life, the mountains crumble into the sea. We know that no matter that these things happen, that he loves us. That he loves us, and we know that because of the cross. So we can hang our hat on that. That is the only guarantee in life that we have, that and the many other promises that God has given to us. So Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11:23, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you.'" It's a command. To not do it is sin. "Do this in remembrance of me." Let us partake of the bread. Then it says in verse 25, "In the same way he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood.'" Do this, another command. Failure to do so is sin. "Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us drink of the cup. And then Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11:26, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And that's a reference to the rapture of the church, which is imminent. So let us close in prayer. Father, we just thank you so much for your people here this morning, and those not only in the Thompson household, but also those on Pal Talk, and those who might be viewing or listening this class at a later date through the website. And Father, we just thank you for the great gift of your Son. Help us, Father. We pray this service would go a long way of helping us to grow more and more close to you and be more and more occupied with your Son, Jesus Christ, and our union with him. Help us to put it into perspective and understand the implications of all these things that we've learned here this morning. We thank you, Father, for loving us. We don't deserve a thing. We're wicked sinners, and we're saved by your grace through faith in your Son. What a great love that you demonstrated toward us. And we pray, Father, that this love would leave a lasting imprint on us, and that it would take root, and it would be watered with the Word, and that we would reflect that love that you demonstrated toward us through your Son and the Spirit, reflect that love back toward you by loving you with our entire being and loving our fellow Christian as you have loved us and all men as you have loved us. And we pray that there's anyone who's listening to my voice on the internet or on Pal Talk that has not believed in Jesus Christ, I'm here to tell you that God so loved the world that he gave his uniquely born Son, that whoever believes in him shall never perish but have eternal life. For the Father did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. So you have a free will of volition, and you can say to the Father in your own words that you're believing in his Son, Jesus Christ. Failure to do so will result in eternal condemnation in the lake of fire, conscious suffering for all of eternity. I don't say this to scare you, just simply to give you the reality. At any moment, you and I could die. We don't have any control over the time, manner, and place of our death. God has that control. Now, you're alive. And if you have not trusted in Jesus as your Savior, now's the time to do so. Because you might not have tomorrow or another 5 minutes left in this world. So the choice is yours. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. To believe in Jesus, acknowledge the fact that you're a sinner and need a Savior. None of us is righteous. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. None are righteous, no, not one. Jesus Christ, the righteous, the Son of God, came so that you and I might have eternal life. So by trusting in him, you're saved. It's that easy to receive eternal life because he did all the hard work. Faith is non-meritorious. It's compatible with God's grace, which means that we don't earn or deserve anything. And that's humbling to the human race, which is filled with pride like its father, the devil. So we just pray, Father, that those who hear my voice would take heed to this message and that some might be plucked from the fire. So, Father, we pray for these things in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Okay, now we're going to take part in giving. We'll take up an offering. And this is a time that we could take part in giving. And let's pray for the offering. I'm going to do a song for the offering called Much of You. Let's pray for the offering. Father, we pray that this offering would be given out of proper motivation, out of love and appreciation for you and your Son, Jesus Christ. And that it would meet our needs. And we just thank you for those who've been faithful in supporting this ministry with their finances. And we pray that if it's your will, that to continue to do so, Father. So we pray that those who give would be blessed by the giving, because your Son has mentioned and said and taught that it's more blessed to give than to receive. So, Father, we pray for this offering in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Okay, this next song is called Much of You by Stephen Curtis Chapman.
Much of me, 'cause I'm just a whisper, and you are the thunder. I want to make much of you, Jesus. I want to make much of your love. I want to live today to give you the praise that you alone are so worthy of. I want to make much of your mercy. I want to make much of your cross. I give you my life. Take it and let it be used to make much of you. And how can I of the cross, thorns and the whip and the nails and the spear, the infinite cost to purchase my pardon and to fill all my shame. To think I have anything worth boasting in except for your name. 'Cause I am a sinner and you are the Savior. And I want to make much of you, Jesus. I want to make much of your love. I want to live today to give you the praise that you alone are so worthy of. I want to make much of your mercy. I want to make much of your cross. I give you my life. Take it and let it be used to make much of you. This is your love, oh God, not to make much of me, but to send your own son so that he could make much of you for all eternity. And I want to make much of you, Jesus. I want to make much of your love. I want to live today to give you the praise that you alone are so worthy of. I want to make much of your mercy. I want to make much of your cross. I give you my life. Take it and let it be used to make much of you. I want to make much of you. So much of you, Jesus.
Thank you, Dismissed. Thank you, everyone.